Hey everyone, Blaze here, welcome back to a discussion video. I haven't done one of these in a while. A few days ago, last week I think, I watched a anime arcology video. It was a clip from one of their streams, I believe, but it was talking about anime burnout and like tips to deal with it. And it's something I've been dealing with for a while. I won't get into the whole thing right now, but like I kind of been dealing with some form of anime burnout for like 2.5 months. So I just thought I'd like piggyback on like some of their tips as well as giving some of my own, and that in how I deal with it, because I've seen a lot of anime. I spend a lot of time watching anime. I really enjoy it. It's literally my main hobby, and yeah. But at times I have struggled with just, there's a lot of anime. Have you realized how much anime there is, especially these days? There's a lot of anime, and I think anime burnout, if it's not something that people realize they're suffering with, it might be something that, you know, is actually probably quite common these days because of how much there is, and just how easily accessible a lot of it is as well. It's easy to just, you know, binge on it, you know, go crazy, and then find yourself feeling sick at the end of it and going, just like, I'm done with this, or like, I just don't want to do this anymore. Like, just overfilling yourself on anime junk food, basically. Yeah, so here's some tips, basically, for how I tend to deal with it. And this is, like, the number one tip. Like, if you find yourself, and this is a tip everyone will give you, like, if you ever find yourself in this position of, like, man, why am I watching anime? There's so much. I'm just like, I've seen so much. It all feels the same now. Like, how do you deal? Like, I'm just done. That's how I feel. Like, that's what happens to people. Like, I just feel like, I get this point of like, I'm just done. I'm done, or I'm getting very close to done. And like, what, the number one tip for that is go back and watch one of your favorite shows. Like, one of your formative favorite shows, one of the first anime that made you fall in love with this to begin with. I did this when I was at, like, back in January of 2022, when I really hit like the worst anime burnout, kind of, well, maybe the second worst actually, that I've ever had. So yeah, I went back and watched my first ever anime, which I hadn't seen for a long time. Like probably about 7 or 8 years at that point, like since I'd last watched it. So I decided to go back and watch Full Metal Alchemist. This is from the collector's edition that Funimation did, but yeah, this is Full Metal Alchemist 2003 on Blu-ray. Yeah, obviously, like, this is my first ever anime. It's incredibly important. It's a lot of people's first ever anime. It's like one of the absolute classics. Like, the fact that Brotherhood exists kind of makes this less important these days, but it was incredibly important at the time. It was one of the big, it was probably the biggest show to come out of the initial anime bubble period back in the early 2000s, and it was I'm sure for a lot of people their first exposure to anime. It's an absolute great series, even though on my rewatch going back to it, I was like, yeah, I can see the flaws in this show now that I couldn't see before. And again, especially in a world where Brotherhood exists, like, this obviously diverges massively, because at some point, like, the manga wasn't finished, so it gets to about the episode 25, 23 episode mark or something, like, about halfway through, and then it just tells its own story within the boundaries of what had already been set up, basically. But, like, it's completely different to what Brotherhood is, and nowhere near as good. It felt amazing at the time, but going back to it, it's like, yeah, I can see some of the flaws in this. There's also like just straight up episodic filler episodes that I never noticed before, even on prior rewatches. But it was a really good time. I really enjoyed it, and it sort of reignited me a bit, you know. So I highly recommend doing something like that. You know, going back and watching a formative show is super important. It doesn't have to be your first anime, you know. It could be within that, like first 10, 20, just a show that you really liked from that time period, like my formative anime of Full Metal Alchemist, Elrica 7, Razaphon, Scrap Princess, like, those are all bone shows, by the way. They were pretty prolific back in the day. But I'm going to add on to this as well, because I think this is this can be work just as well, within reason, is maybe go back and also, after you've done that, and you're looking for maybe another rewatch just to keep you going, I recommend going back and watching something that maybe you liked really back in the day, that you've just sort of maybe forgotten about as well to some degree, because the rest of the anime world and community has sort of forgotten about it. But it doesn't mean that show wasn't good, and it does, and you'll have lots of nostalgia for it. So it's not going to be a show that you're going to go back to and go, wow, turns out this show was 10 out of 10. I was like, no, maybe it was always 7 out of 10. Turns out this show was always a 7 out of 10 or an 8 out of 10 or something that was a good scores or great scores. But still, like, go back to something that maybe you've forgotten about but would have nostalgia for and is a little bit more obscure to keep things fresh, so it's not just like the same old, you know, tentpole shows, as important as those are. Like, for example, I went back and when I, in my hour of need of my anime burnout year of 2022, and kind of mostly into last year, in fact, I went back to Gun Frontier, which just happened to be a show that I watched really early on in my fandom, like around, within the first 20 shows or something. Like, I had, when I first got into anime, I've talked about this before in the past on the channel, I was actually collecting bootlegs. I didn't know they were bootlegs. This was just a thing that would happen to people in the year 2000s. eBay was a freaking, even worse than it is now, to some degree. I mean, sometimes better, sometimes worse, I don't know. But there was a lot of bootlegs on eBay, and just like, the person who sold me on, oh, you should watch Full Metal Alchemist. Like, the person who basically introduced anime to me was buying these bootlegs, so I just, like, I knew no better. So yeah, I actually saw this in a bootleg. They actually made bootlegs of this, believe it or not. It's crazy. So yeah, not as obscure as maybe you think. But yeah, I really enjoyed going back to watching this show, like a fun single core show. It was the first time I'd ever watched a Leiji Matsumoto show, like Leijiverse show back in the day. This was my introduction to Harlock and Totoro and stuff. So yeah, like, I enjoy going back to it. I remember enjoying it back then, to be honest. Going back to it, I enjoyed it even more. I actually enjoyed this one more on a rewatch. It's great stuff. This is a Discotheque release. I did a weird thing where, because I had the Media Blasters release, and like when this went out of print, I was just kind of like, I kind of want the compact release as well, and I kind of don't want to miss out on a Discotheque Leijiverse release for some reason. So I basically Frankenstein them together. So I've got the four volumes here. Can't do the mirrored camera thing. For the Media Blasters release, and then the two Discotheque DVDs. So I got the better bitrate, at least in theory, on the Media Blasters release. So yeah, anyway, whatever, I'm not sure why I decided to share that right now, but yeah, Gun Frontier. And then another one that I did it with was Midori Days, which again, like, a show that I'm sure most people might have like some recollection of if you watched it back in the day. I would hope you maybe even have a fond recollection of it. And again, this was like, this one in particular was in like the first five shows I ever watched, because I kind of, like, you know, I watched Fullmetal Alchemist, I watched Chrono Crusade, I think, and like a couple of other things, like Erica 7 and stuff. But yeah, I just thought, well, let's watch something completely different. So I picked this one up back in the day. Again, a bootleg. And yeah, I just remember really enjoying it. I used to have loads of, like, they did, like, hand, because this Midori ends up turning into this guy's right hand. Lots of teen comedy angles, you can guess from that. Anyway, and she's got, like, a major crush on him. Anyway, yeah, but because she was like this hand puppet thing, like, or like could be cosplayed as such, like they made like a bunch of those, and I had like a couple of those. I sold all those on. I used to have all the manga, and it's really hard to get now. I had it all, and I sold it in the lull period of the time where I didn't watch this show. And yeah, so when I went back to it in 2022, I kind of, like, I didn't regret getting rid of the models as such. Like, they were fine, but like, I don't mind. But the manga, I so regret getting rid of, because it's really expensive and hard to get now. But anyway, yeah, I really love Midori Days. And it's like, so that's what I mean, like, doesn't always have to be, like, the big shows. I mean, some would argue that Scrap Princess in particular maybe isn't, like, a massive show. But I feel like a lot of people, it's pretty well rated, and a lot of people saw it back then. But yeah, like, that is a thing for me. Like, go back to formative shows, go back to your favourites, like, tentpole, you know, anime shows from your past, and I think that will really help kind of galvanize you a bit and feel like, yeah, I remember why I liked all this stuff. It's because of shows like this. So, yeah, another thing I sort of recommend, because again, this is from my own experience, is there's a sort of multi-layered this, right? So, go back to classics that are highly rated in the community that you may have watched and maybe didn't feel quite the same way, but given your more experience now, like I'm thinking things that you watched pretty early on that people said, oh, you should watch this, it'll be amazing, and maybe you didn't like it as much, but go back to it and see if you change your mind, because that's what happened with me. A pretty major one happened with me, and this happened when I don't want to get into this, right, but like it's not like a super serious thing, it's something that happens to everyone, but that something happened in 2023, you know, my personal life or whatever, that kind of affected me, and I went straight headfirst, headstrong into decorating and stuff afterwards, just to take my mind off it. It was something I've been meaning to do for ages, so that's why I've been like doing that over like the last little whiles, like a year and a bit at this point, I guess, off and on. Anyway, in that period, like I kind of just fell off anime entirely, like, and it was like a combination of two things, right? Like dealing with some sort of anime burnout and dealing with this thing, and it was just kind of like, yeah, I just don't want to do this anymore, or at least at the moment. So like, I think I basically watched like one show in an entire month and then fell off it again and didn't come back for a while, but when I decided to come back, I decided to do this. So this is why I'm going to recommend this. I don't know if this is a great recommendation or not, but I decided to go back and watch something that everyone tells me I should love, but I wasn't always a huge fan of it. I didn't hate it, I just thought it wasn't as good as everyone said it was. So, and now that I owned it all, like, I've owned it, so it was kind of one of those things, I've had this for a while, I should probably watch it then, shouldn't I? So, I went back to Evangelion. So, at the time, I'd seen, well, basically, all of this, and this was on the horizon for coming out, which also kind of led me to wanting to do this at the time. But yeah, I went back to Evangelion, and something amazing happened. I absolutely fell head over heels in love with Evangelion, despite the fact I'd seen it before and didn't like it a whole lot. I think I gave it a 7, like I thought that was a decent mecha, but you know, I wasn't like, you know, I'm an Erica 7 fan, that's my favourite mecha. I'm a Razaphon fan, that's also one of my favourites, and like Razaphon is very much like Erica 7. Evangelion, so like it's the Ava-like, really. Like, you know, I have my preference. I still have my preference. I prefer Razaphon. There's a lot of nostalgia to it as well, but I just do. But yeah, I was sort of somewhat dismissive of Evangelion. So, yeah, going back to it and this beautiful Blu-ray set, I actually watched this with the Netflix dub, would you believe? The reason for that was my room was empty at the time because I was painting. The only thing I had in there was my sofa, which I was strategically moving around the room to not get paint on it while I was painting the walls, and my TV, which I was doing the same thing, kind of. I was like just pushing it back and forth away from the wall towards the wall as and when appropriate. So yeah, that's all I had in there, and my Blu-ray player. So the reason I decided to watch Evangelion with the Netflix dub is the Netflix dub has closed captions for the dub, which is really cool. So I could watch it dubbed in English, which just makes it easier to follow because the room was super echoey, and I could watch it with subtitles as well, so it's double whammy, I'll be able to understand all of it despite all the echo in this room. So yeah, decided to go back and watch Evangelion and really enjoyed the Netflix dub, to be honest. Like, it might even be weirdly my preference now, despite the fact that I went out of my way specifically to get this release so I could have the old dubs. But yeah, I thought the Netflix dub was really cool, to be honest. Anyway, and then I followed it up with the Rebuild movies, which culminated in this movie, which I absolutely love this movie. Like, well, I absolutely love the ending of this movie, and I absolutely love the still weird high that I'm living off the end of this movie. Like, genuinely. Like, the ending to all of Evangelion, because if you're not aware, actually, all of Evangelion is kind... This is all one story. They all connect. Like, this isn't just a remake. There's more to it than that. So, yeah, if you aren't aware of that, I highly recommend watching all of these and getting aware of that. So, yeah, anyway, but... Yeah, I've been on such a high with the ending to Ava. I just loved it. And it made me fall in love with anime all over again. So, yeah, like... I don't know if this is a great recommendation, but yeah, another thing might be to go back and watch something that maybe, you know, that is lauded, that maybe you just didn't get the first time, for whatever reason, be it through just general experience and how much you've seen, or just, you just didn't get it. But now I do get it, and I love it. Evangelion's great. Right. So, more normal things. To deal with anime burnout would be quite simply watch less. Try and watch a little bit less. If you're watching a lot to the point where you feel like you're burnt out, watch a bit less. This isn't always the greatest recommendation, to be honest, because there's a chance you'll fall off the hobby entirely. But it's also quite easily possible, I know from experience, that you're just watching too much stuff. You're just watching too much stuff. Just watch less. Like, a lot of this anime ain't going anywhere. Like, the shows that you feel like you need to watch right now in the moment, you don't. They're not going anywhere. I know we got, like, you get this thing about, like, digital scarcity and, like, you know, because things are digital and they disappear forever. Not everything comes out on Blu-ray and DVD, you know, as a collector, and that frustrates me. But, you know, there are ways to see stuff, you know. People are doing the work behind the scenes around the internet and in the community that, you know, these shows are out there to be found if you're desperate enough. So you can find stuff. It's okay. You don't need to watch everything in the moment. And, you know, the majority of stuff that's on Crunchyroll every season, a lot of that stuff ain't going to disappear off Crunchyroll for a long time. Like, most of that, you know, Crunchyroll has stuff that they streamed, like, over 10 years ago. Still there. In fact, probably longer than that. Still on their service, available to be streamed, so you don't need to worry about it. Just watch a bit less. So more specifically, I think, and this is, I feel like this can go two ways, right? Because try, but like, watching less, but maybe actually try and watch less and finish the less that you're watching. You know what I mean? Like, finish the stuff that you're watching. I find a lot of people will watch tons of different shows all at the same time, and it works for some people. It definitely doesn't work for me. And the reason why I say this can go one or two ways really is that I'm the complete opposite end of this spectrum, where I watch one thing at a time, because I find that if I try and watch more than one thing at a time, if the other thing I start watching at the same time as something else ends up being more interesting to me, the last thing I want to do a lot of the time is watch the thing that's less interesting. I want to watch the thing that really is currently grabbing my attention. And another way to look at that also is that, you know, newer things tend to be more interesting, more refreshing, at least at the beginning. So, yeah, like, I feel like you would find yourself dropping more stuff because the early episodes of things are more exciting than maybe the middle part. Or the end. But I definitely feel like finishing things, I mean, you shouldn't force yourself to finish anything. Like, if you don't like it, you don't like it. Like, for sure, don't do that. But, like, you know, if you find yourself, you're watching, like, 10, 15 shows a season, if not 20, or just, like, just in your general, even if you're not watching seasonal anime, like, just in general, you're watching, like, 5, 10 shows at once, like, and you're struggling to finish some, maybe just watch less and try and finish those less that you're watching. As I said, like, try and finish those. Finish stuff. Get to the conclusion of things. Get the resolution, even though there are a lot of anime that don't have proper resolutions. But you know what I mean? Like, just get to the end. Get the satisfaction of, if you're on an anime list or Anime Planet or whatever, you know, get the satisfaction of completing something and knowing that you finished it, knowing that you've seen it all. Like, I think that's important. And, like, the more you're watching, the harder that's going to be to do. The harder it is to not just put things on stall, because you'll be, if you're watching tons of different things at once, like, it's, you know, really hard to keep up on the ins and outs of all these different shows, especially in the day and age we live now, where, like, there's, like, God, what, still every season, like, 5 or 6 isekai shows, and that, maybe that's an understatement, I don't know. I don't watch them anymore, but, like, if they're all kind of very similar, because that's how they feel to me, you know, you're going to struggle to get through all those, and maybe, yeah, that's not a great idea. So when I say on the flip side to that, as the polar extreme to that with me, where I watch one thing at once, the problem with that can be that sometimes I stick with shows because I like to finish things, not everything, but I do like to try and finish things, like 95% of what I watch I finish. Sometimes I'll stick with stuff that I'm not liking, but I need to stick with it because I know if I leave it now, I'll probably never go back to it. That can be the same with long shows as well. Sometimes I'll be watching a really long show because I'm watching it and it's the only thing I'm watching. I know, like, if I stop now with, like, 50 episodes to go, which is a perfectly normal thing to do and want to do, if it, like, I'm just getting burnt out on the show a little bit, like, I've just kind of had my fill, but if I stop now, I know I won't go back to it for, like, 2-3 years maybe sometimes, and that kind of sucks. So, yeah, there's, like, a flip side to that. I feel like you need to find that balance for you, and, like, if you're burning out, it might be because you're watching too much and not finishing enough as well, so you're not getting the satisfaction at the end of it. So, yeah, another tip, a quick one, I guess, especially if you're struggling to know what to watch next, I actually have quite a few tips for this. If you're struggling what to watch next, get into little projects, and by that, I mean, I have quite a few of these. Like, I have a project that I've been doing for years and years, which is literally, I call it the year project. I've mentioned it on this channel before. But I made it my goal as, like, someone who likes, you know, the whole spectrum of anime and wants to see, like, anime from all decades and all this sort of thing. I made it my goal at one point to watch at least one TV series for every single year of anime that I can. At least one. Currently, I can say I've done that from 1977... all the way to 2023. I don't think I've watched a show that came out this year yet, but I'm pretty sure I watched something that came out last year. So yeah, that's quite a large spectrum. I mean, that's literally 46 years of anime that I've watched in that time, which is, yeah, kind of mental actually. I'm pretty sure that's the right math, so yeah. But yeah, that's a project that I have really enjoyed doing. And, like, it's just an example of things you can do to just kind of mix things up. It's not something I do all the time. It's not my main focus. It's never been a real focus. It's just like, oh, I want to watch something from the 80s. Or what's a year that I hadn't... This is, you know, when I still had a lot of gaps. Like, what's a year that I haven't filled in? Oh, 1983. Okay, let's go and watch Cat's Eye from 1983. I own it. I should watch it. I bought it, so I should watch it. So I fill in that year. I get to see something that I wanted to see off the shelf and things like that. And you can do that for all sorts of things, that you can change it into just, you know, I want to watch one anime for every year from a certain genre or something. Like, I want to watch a sci-fi show for every year. I want to watch, like, a shonen show for every year. Or, you know, I want to watch one show from every season from, like, the last 10 years if old anime aren't your thing or something like that, you know. Just, and it means you can go back and get to things that maybe you've missed out on potentially, and just things like that. And I like little projects like that. Another one that I like to do that helps me to get to things that I just aren't necessarily on my radar, and, like, the world isn't beaming at me telling me that I should be watching, so I know I sort of need to force myself to do it, is to, like, put myself in a bit of a box. Like, for example, I haven't done it with this year specifically, but this is, I decided to do this as the example. I did it for other years, I did it for the year prior to that, 1997, but let's put ourselves in a box called 1998, and I'm just going to live as, for the next little bit, until I get bored, basically, I'm going to live in the world of anime from 1998, and I'm going to watch only things that came out in 1998. 1998, if you're not aware, is actually, like, one of the craziest years for anime, period. It's also one of the greatest years in video games, I'm pretty sure. But, like, for anime, it kind of also is. Like, Japan just knocking it out of the park in 1998. Because, you know, Cowboy Bebop came out in 1998. And you probably also know that Initial D came out in 1998. So did Zero Experiments Lane. Outlaw Star. Cardcaptor Sakura. And I'm pretty sure Trigun, maybe this came out in 1999, but I'm pretty sure it came out in 1998. And those are all, like, absolute classics. You might have seen them all, potentially. And you might be thinking, well, you know, that was a good idea, Blaze, but, you know, I've kind of seen all the big anime from 1998. And I'm like, well, obviously they made more than that, man. Like, way more. There's so much more stuff you can still experience. This is all stuff from 1998, right? Record of Lotus War, Chronicles of the Heroic Knight. Princess Nine, another really highly rated one. His and Her Circumstances, a much less highly rated one, though personally I enjoy it. Nazca, also came out in 1998. The anime from the Malcolm in the Middle opening. The original season of Orphan came out in 1998. Generator Ghoul, a show that was quite early in ADV's history or whatever. It was one of the first TV series they ever did. It's actually a really cool time travel series, but most people have sort of forgotten it. Most people aren't huge fans of it, but it came out in 1998, and I think it's pretty good. The Devil Man Lady, or Devil Lady. Lost Universe. There's a lot, guys. There's so much. So much I can't even reach it all. Kurigane Communication, an absolutely beautiful series. Gasaraki, a somewhat disappointing mecha series, but still, it was kind of cool. Neoranga, an absolutely amazing series from 1998. there's still more. Master Keaton also came out in 1998. It's amazing how much of these came out physically as well. Silent Mobius came out in 1998. I need to get the compact release for this. And also Bubblegum Crisis 2040. It's over there. I can't reach it anymore because I'm surrounded by DVDs. But yeah, you know, like a year project like that. And that's just TV series. Like, freaking loads of other great anime came out in 1998. Like, movies-wise. I can't remember specifically off the top of my head. Like, I think Princess Mononoke was 1997. So, I can't remember. I think Spriggan might have came out in 1998, which is kind of cool. But yeah, you know, this is... It's fun, man. Like, that's what I mean, like, in terms of, like, helping with anime burnout, like, you might think you've seen the best of the best from a given year, maybe you don't think about it either, I don't know, but, like, you might be surprised just how much anime comes out in a given year, even back then, even back in 1998, like, I have all of that, and that's not even all the stuff you can buy physically, there are things I don't own that also came out in 1998, with dubs and everything, and there's obviously a lot of stuff that didn't come out physically, and some of that stuff even has fan subs, it's a lot of anime all the time, and maybe that's a little bit overwhelming, but I just think that's a really fun project. It's something I've enjoyed doing. I've done it for, like, 1997, 94, 2004. I can't remember which year in the 80s. I think it was 1987, because that was the year I was born, so I think I did it then as well. You know, I just do it for a bit. I don't stay around forever. I don't decide to go right now and watch everything, because that would be insane. That's not going to be... that's not going to help with burnout, is it? But... yeah, I just decided to watch a ton of stuff from a given year, and I think that's really fun. I think it's worth doing. And, like, there are other things as well, like, you don't have to go as crazy as that. You could just go, another example I brought to hand, like, oh, I really like this character designer. Well, look him up. What other stuff did he do? Watch anime with his character designs in it. For example, I really like the character designs of Kenichi Sonoda. You know, he worked on Bubblegum Crisis. He did loads of stuff back in the day, like Galforce. Well, you know, he worked on the stuff as a character designer on, like, Galforce and stuff. Some of his mangas and things got adapted to Riding Bean, Gunsmith Cats. Like, there's loads of things you can go into. And there's loads of different character designers that have got works across multiple anime. And obviously, you know, another obvious one would be directors. And actually, weirdly, didn't bring anything to hand for that. But, you know, like... for example, with Evangelion, you know, did you really like Evangelion? Have you seen the other stuff that Arno worked on? You know, stuff like that. I think it's really worth doing. There might be more obscure stuff where you not necessarily know the director. Maybe they're not well known. But if it's a show that they made that you really, really love, maybe you should go and watch more stuff they worked on. Like, for example, as I'm saying this, I'm thinking, I love Elreka 7. Maybe I should go and watch other stuff that this guy directed, assuming that, you know, it's a guy and assuming that he directed other things. Director Kyoda Tomoki. Or Tomoki Kyoda. I assume it's the other way around. So yeah, Kyoda Tomoki. Yeah, I don't think I know if I how much of his stuff I've seen, but I should probably go and watch other things. That would be a fun project for me to do at some point. So yeah, I think coming up with projects like that, like little fun things that you can work on, and, you know, with no pressure, like, you don't have to, like, no one cares if you watch everything from 1998, no one cares how much you watch, but, like, if there's some things you haven't seen, even if you've seen all the big ones, like, maybe, you, like I said, maybe you'd seen Cardcaptor, Trigun, Cowboy Bebop, Initial D, Serial Experiments, Lame, like, maybe you've seen all those, but there's loads of other stuff that you might not have seen, but know about as well. That's the other thing, like, there's loads of shows out there you might know about, but haven't seen. And also, I guess, maybe the final thing, because this video is getting really long, and I think I might be running out of things that are relevant to say, even though I'm sure I'll come up with other things after I turn off the blooming camera. But this is something else that's also relevant to me right now, is making sure that you watch the right things sometimes. Like, when you're in a lull, making sure you watch the right things. Like, I'm of the opinion you should watch what you want to watch when you want to watch it. And, like, even if you, you know, if something takes your fancy, because especially since I've got, like, this huge collection, like, sometimes if I want to watch something that's, I'll grab it to hand, actually, it's over here. You know, if I want to watch something that's a bit more obscure at some point, like Haunted Junction, which I've owned in my collection forever, and I suddenly finally have the urge to put it in my Blu-ray player, I'm not going to rob myself of that chance to finally see this thing that I've owned for all this time, because it's, you know, not highly rated. But I've kind of lost the beginning of where I was going with this, but, like, something I've been doing right now and trying to do right now is to watch things that are known to be good by the wider community. And, like, so when I'm in that lull period, when I'm in that moment where things aren't feeling so great, and, like, I'm sort of like, oh, I don't know what to watch now, and there's so much to pick from, but I've seen so much, what do I do now, like, sort of thing, like, it's good to get to something that appeals to you that maybe you just haven't seen. So maybe it's not that urge to just take it off the shelf, maybe it's something you go, what was that thing, or, you know, let me look into some stuff that's really highly rated, that's, you know, in this case it was, like, really highly rated and old school, because that's kind of what I want to be doing right now. But something I own, but also something I haven't seen yet. And that landed me on El Hazard, which I've just been meaning to get to for the longest time, and I've owned for the longest time. Well, actually, in this case, I actually haven't. I just realised, like, yeah, I never owned the DVDs for these. I was never able to get them, but I bought the Blu-rays, which are really up and down in terms of quality. But I'm currently in the midst of watching El Hazard. I've seen everything in this set, which is the first two OVAs. The OVAs. So you've got the first seven episodes in beautiful HD mastered from the film negatives, and then everything else in this collection. And this one is an upscale after that. But I love El Hazard. Like, it was so weird as well, because I'm, like, so done with modern isekai. Like, I haven't watched one probably since In Another World with my smartphone, which is a fucking terrible show. But yeah, like, I don't know why I even watched that show back in the day, but whatever. But yeah, like, in terms of, like, just modern isekai in general, like, it's just, like, terrible to me, the majority of it. I'm sure some of it's good, but I just don't care to watch any of it at the moment. But yeah, weirdly, despite the fact I think I was moaning about isekai on Twitter, like, literally 2 days before I decided to watch this, which is 100% isekai, but it was classic isekai, and I loved it. I loved the humour in it a lot as well, and it's a relatively high rated series, like, from back in the day. Maybe not something that's as highly rated as it was once upon a time, because it's, you know, older now. But yeah, I genuinely, genuinely love this. Like, more than most. Like, most people on my anime list, my friends, have, like, got it at, like, 8 and 7s. I gave it a 9. Like, it was exactly what the doctor ordered for me. It was fantastic. I absolutely loved it. So yeah, I watched all of this. And I skip this for now, because this is literally just the OVA, the 7-episode OVA, like, redone as a TV series, from what I understand, like a 26-episode TV series. and like it's sort of standalone as a result, kind of, I think. I can't quite recall, but yeah, I decided not to bother with this one right now, but because yeah, after these two you get another TV series which I'm currently watching. I'm only two episodes into it. I watched two episodes yesterday. But yeah, El Hazard, The Alternative World, which is another TV series from 1998, actually, as it turns out. There's a lot of anime from 1998. Yeah, so currently watching this and absolutely loving it. Just really enjoying these characters and the humour and just the world in general. Although this one's The Alternative World. This is an isekai, inside an isekai, this one. Like, you get human characters from Japan going to a fantasy world. And now that they've been in the fantasy world for a while, they're now getting isekai'd from that fantasy world into a whole different alternative world. I'm pretty sure that seemed to be the cliffhanger from episode 2. So, yeah. But yeah, enjoying El Hazard at the moment. And like I said, maybe that's another good thing to try and do more often than not when you're hitting that little moment, is to just go, okay, so what does the community at large tell me I should be watching that maybe I haven't seen? You know, what's in my wheelhouse? Like, what's, you know, what sort of thing am I interested in watching right now? But maybe I can, you know, lean to the what the community says from this period that I should be watching, which is what I did with El Hazard, and it's paid off greatly. Like, El Hazard is relatively well rated, something I hadn't seen, so I watched it, and at 39 minutes in this video, although I'm sure there'll be some editing to do, I think I'm gonna call it there. I'm not really sure what this video was. Like I said, this video is long. Like I said, after editing, probably 35 minutes plus. But I tried to film like three different versions of this in this current like moment, you know, in this recording session. So there's like another 40 minutes or whatever of me starting this video and then restarting it and restarting it and restarting it until I finally got to this one, the final take, where I'm done. I don't know what else to say, really. I'm not really sure, I'm not really sure what this video is, but I'm hoping that long-time subscribers and maybe anyone who falls onto this video who's suffering from some form of anime burnout will get something from it. Maybe, I don't know. I think I'll leave it there, because I literally don't know what else to say, so. I'm Blaze. If you somehow made it to the end, thanks for watching. I really appreciate it. Like, a lot. I really appreciate it. Because, yeah, this film? This video, which is almost a film length, it feels like. This video is a bit of a rumble and mumble, and I don't know what I'm saying anymore. I'm Blaze. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next.